Welcome to Wind in Caves Podcast. I'm Bubba.
And I'm Tiny.
And today we're going over Season 1, Episodes 1, Secrets, and Episode 2, Lies. If you have it, Tiny, why are you making that face at me? The end is the beginning.
Oh, I get it. That's super funny.
Yeah, you didn't laugh once at that very funny, possibly not funny joke. Welcome to Wind in Caves, everybody. We are going over Season 3, Episode 7, In Between Time, or Episode 7, Between the Time, and Episode 8, The Paradise. We are covering every episode of Dark that exists. Tiny, if they haven't watched all three seasons of Dark, what should they do?
Spoiler alert, if you have not watched all three seasons, you should especially not listen to this episode of Wind in Caves and instead rewind back in time, watch all three seasons, and listen to all podcast recaps.
We are going to be going over everything. We're going to be talking about everything. We're going to be going over your feedback, and we are bringing back some of our segments from the first couple of Wind in Caves podcasts. Yes, Tiny, that's right. We are bringing back crazy theories.
Oh, no.
At the end of this podcast, Bubba, I have used to give out all a bunch of crazy theories. They were always wrong. So I thought for the end of the beginning, I'm going to give away my new final first crazy theory.
Let's hear it.
Okay, you want to hear it right now rather than wait till the end? I think that while it seems like that's the end, I think we've just reached a new beginning. I think there's a huge clue that this isn't happening for the first time.
The end, beginning, potato, potato.
Tiny, when Alt, Martha, and Jonas are there after the rainstorm, after they've stopped Tannhaus's son, daughter-in-law, and granddaughter Charlotte from driving onto that bridge where they would get pushed into the river. They talk about their time in that mystical area with all the lights, where Jonas says, when we were in that area, I saw you as a child. And what did Martha say? Yeah, in my closet, I remember this. How could she remember it if it had never happened before?
Dun, dun, dun.
There's more to the crazy theory, Tiny, but I'm going to hold off for a bit. But Tiny, another thing we're going to bring back to the Wind in Caves podcast that we used to do that we haven't been doing as much anymore. We're going to bring back some time traveling into the podcast. Are you excited?
Some double tease?
That's right. We always talk about time travelers. Well, this podcast is going to have some time traveling. All season three long, we've been talking about giving away a copy of A Journey Through Time, the H.G. Tannhaus tie-in novel that Dark has released, the English language version of it. We're going to give it away to one double L.
Loyal listener.
Who has been kind enough to do certain things on social media like hashtag out Wind in Caves podcast or leave us a review on iTunes, YouTube, that kind of thing. Because we are recording this, listeners, on July 8th of 2020, but we will not release it until
after you're listening to it.
Until July 13th. And so we're not going to draw a name out now, Tiny. We're going to draw out a name on the 12th. So you ready to travel through time and pull out the name of the lucky listener who wins?
Absolutely.
It's the future, Tiny. How do you feel?
Older.
Can you believe it was 4 days ago when we recorded the podcast, but now here we are in the future. Tiny, you have to do this. You have to do this or the whole world will be destroyed.
What if I change my path?
Damn it, young Jonas. So, Tiny, we're about to pull our winner of the prize, where we're giving away the tie-in novel, the English language version of H.G. Tannhaus's A Journey Through Time novel, to one lucky listener. We're going to talk about how you entered into the contest, and that's once again by giving us hashtag Winning Caves Podcast on any social media platform or giving us written iTunes review. And Tiny, to give people an idea how they entered, why don't you read this review we got?
Absolutely. On the UK iTunes store, we heard from Yup OK, and he/she said, everything they do is double G. Guaranteed gold.
Oh, thank you so much. So Yup OK is entered into this contest. Tiny, I want you to reach your hand into the bowl and pick a winner for this incredible prize.
Okay, well, this is a lucky winner. Looks like chances of winning are about 1 in 3,000. And the winner is... Wow, Joe Bear from iTunes. Congrats, Joe Bear.
Joe Bear from the U.S. iTunes store. Thank you so much. We have so many people in this bowl. I feel bad that we just have one prize, but listeners, we still need reviews. We apologize if you didn't win this time. We need reviews. It's how you get noticed. It's how you get discovered. Wind in Caves, Double P Podcast, we need you to give reviews. Tiny, since we recorded all that time, long time ago in the past, have you heard the latest crazy dark thing that has come up?
I have not.
Do you remember H.G. Tannhaus's daughter-in-law's name?
No.
It was Sonja. That's Sonja with a J. S-O-N-J-A. Do you know what word you can spell with those letters?
Jonas.
Exactly right. Now, do you remember the name of H.G. Tannhaus's son?
No.
Well, on the podcast we recorded a long time ago in the past, I kept pronouncing it as Merrick. But it's actually spelled and might likely be pronounced Marek. So, Tannhaus's son and the daughter-in-law, people are questioning, are they? Because HG was trying to create his Tannhaus in the origin world to save, create his time machine in the origin world to save him. Is his son Marek, Martha, and his daughter-in-law, Sonja, Jonas? What do you think about that crazy theory?
I think it's a crazy theory, but, you know, for this show, it might just work.
All right, now, Tiny, we got to travel back to the past and finish the podcast.
Oh, we're back. Can you believe it, Tiny? Are you proud of that double L?
Loyal listener?
Who won?
Congratulations, the contest. It was a tight race.
We pulled your name out, whoever you are, we mention in the future. Congratulations, you've earned it.
Oh my gosh, I've never won anything before.
That was a terrible impersonation of insert winner's name here. Tiny, okay, we've got so much listener feedback that we can't wait to get to. But before we do anything else, let's get to it. What did you think? Are you satisfied with the ending of Dark?
Well, Bubba, tonight we watched 2 episodes together. And I have to tell you, after episode 7, I was a little bit nervous.
Why was that?
I just felt like it was the ultimate recap episode, which, you know, obviously is good for this type of show. You need to get your mind straight before they close the loop.
Right.
Or untie the knot. But I didn't feel like it moved the story forward very much. And so I was a little bit let down with episode 7, to be honest.
Okay. Well, what about episode 8? The actual ending, question mark?
Or beginning.
Or the beginning, right.
You know, episode 8 I liked. I liked that there was some finality to it. Even if we're going to continue theories that it may just be another beginning, I still liked that it had a quote-unquote ending.
Tiny, I love that you say that. Listeners, we want you to join in with us. Yes, the podcast is over. We won't be reading your feedback on the air anymore. But if you're listening to this and have thoughts, please put them in those YouTube comments. Write to us on our Facebook page, facebook.com/doublePHQ. That's the word double, the single letter P, then the letters HQ for headquarters. Or hit us up on Instagram or Twitter at doublePHQ. We want to know your thoughts. So those were Tiny's thoughts. Tiny, I love that you said that, because in some ways, I'm the exact opposite. Episode 7 had so much where it was connecting the dots. How did young Jonas become Stranger Jonas? How did Stranger Jonas become Adam? How did Noah, what was his journey? These kind of things. And I thought it delivered him great. But it also was giving us new information. And at the time, I wasn't really that interested in Tannhaus's information. But I was definitely interested in, oh, wait a minute. Claudia just shot Alt Claudia? Claudia's trying to do these things? I loved it. And then that musical montage at the end of episode 7, which was showing us all the scenes we'd already seen, but now we knew how they all fit together. I loved it, loved it, loved it. Then episode 8 hit. And honestly, a part of me was like, do I really care about Tannhaus's kids? We just met them. I don't really know them. You know, the idea that they're... survival is so important. It's hard. I found it hard to get emotionally invested in their survival. And once again, we hadn't spent 26 hours with them. We'd spent 26 hours with Jonas and Martha and all the people of Linden. But as I've sat with it, I'm becoming more and more satisfied with the end, partially because of my crazy theories that we'll go into deeper later. So I loved episode 7. Episode 8, I was like, but I'm growing to like it.
Well, what do you think about these kids that survived and how that would have stopped the splinter in time? I mean, I don't know. You can push us to the back of the episode, Bubba, if you want to, but all I can't stop thinking about... You know, his son was telling him, all you talk about is black holes and drops and oceans and time. You know, do we really think that the son, who Tin House hasn't spent much time paying attention to, it seems like, otherwise he wouldn't have a grudge on his shoulder.
Yeah, Merrick.
It's really going to stop this interest in the black hole in time travel? Or, you know, is he just going to pause it and take it up on a different day?
Tiny, those are great questions. I'll do you two more questions to it. Here, Merrick, the son of H.G. Tanhouse, is complaining so much about, oh, you're obsessed with black holes and all these relative theories. Well, guess what, Merrick? If your dad wasn't obsessed with those things, you would be dead in the river.
Yeah. Last word, Merrick.
Right. So, Merrick, believe it or not, your dad created a time machine to save your life. And although he got there in the craziest route imaginable that he couldn't have imagined, the fact that his dad did build that time machine did save his life.
Wow, mind blown. I didn't think about it that way, but that's totally true.
Listeners, we are coming up with your crazy theories, so please, once again, give us yours, even post. Well, at the end of this podcast, we're going to go over the feedback we received before this recording. We also got some great audio from Susan, part of the Geek Girl Soup podcast. Great team. But we got to go deeper into this ending because that's what we're all thinking about at this point. So we go into what kind of online they're calling the origin world, or H.G. Tanhouse's world, where his son Merrick, his daughter-in-law, and their granddaughter Charlotte survived. And we cut to a scene of people at a dining room table. And of course, it's people at the dining room table who, number one, didn't need time travel to be born. And number two, they had all died in the series. That was, Hannah had been killed by her son Jonas in a really horrific scene in episode 7. Oh my lord. Peter had been killed by the scavengers post-apocalypse. Katharina had been killed by her mom by going back in time.
Mom, terrible.
And both the Waller boys, meaning one-eyed Torben, the Gop Waller, who we just loved, he had died in the apocalypse, as had his brother Benny/Bernadette.
And then Regina. Right. But don't forget,
right. Regina
had
died.
Claudia is
right.
The one who gets her way, I guess.
Oh, Tiny, it's so smart that you said that. So there's an interview with the showrunners, and specifically the, I hope I'm pronouncing this somewhat close, Yantis Fries, the woman who wrote most of these episodes all by herself. They asked her about, well, what did you want for the ending? What did you think about the ending? And this was her quote. She said, and when she says we, she's talking about her and her co-creator. She says, we always wanted to save Regina. That was the thing Claudia wanted to achieve. We wanted to make sure we got there. We wanted to end on something that looked normal. We wanted it to be something that everybody can relate to, dinner with family and friends. So here, the showrunners wanted to end on saving Regina. That was the thing Claudia wanted to achieve. So it appears like the showrunners were on #TeamClaudia.
Yeah, I mean, but it would seem really normal, except for a little bit of a downer at the party. Hannah doesn't seem to have shaken her dark side and really brings the party down.
Did you like, Tiny, that Hannah ended up with Waller? Why is that so tricky? In season 2, Waller had told Clausen, yeah, Hannah married Michael. Nobody knew why. She was so beautiful, she could have ended up with anybody. And then in season 3, Altworld, Waller kept giving the stink eye to Ulrich, who was, of course, married and had gotten Hannah pregnant.
Yeah.
Waller won!
Waller always had his eye on Hannah.
His eye or eyes, depending on which world it was. That's exactly right. We do have to mention the mystery that's confused everybody. Waller's eye. Tiny, what do you think?
Well, I thought it was funny. I think that it showed maybe the writers had a little bit of a sense of humor for somebody to say, oh, Waller, your eye looks a little like it's healing up.
Yeah, well, you never told us what happened with it.
No, it's just funny that they're going to let you know, and then he's interrupted, I guess, so he never gets into his eye story, and so it stays a big mystery of Dark.
We need a fourth world where they tell us what happened to Woller's eye.
Yeah, no, Woller, I guess, is going to remain best character.
Oh, love it, love it. Listeners, who's your best character at Double PHQ? Another weird thing about that dining room scene is in the what we're now calling Adam's world, Peter was a therapist and he had gone to see Bernadette in her sex trailer in the what we called the alt world, but now we'll call Eva's world. Peter was a minister, but he seemed to have a special moment in the pews with the Benny version of Bernadette. And here in what we're calling the origin world, Peter and Bernadette are at Regina's for dinner. Aw, they got together in that world. One thing that is crazy, though, is because we found out Regina was not the child of Tronte, which is what we all assumed, which Eva's floor. You know, this is things carved in stone you would assume were correct.
Right, right.
Eva and Adam both assumed that Regina was Claudia's child with Tronte Nielsen, a.k.a. Ulrich's father. But she wasn't. You know what that means? That means that Regina wasn't created by time travel. In both of the off-worlds, her husband Alexander / Boris Niewald was not created by time travel. That means Bartosz was not created by time travel, yet Bartosz doesn't exist in the origin world.
Didn't make it to the dinner party.
He doesn't exist. We find out that Alexander, in both Adam's world and Eva's world, was a guy named Boris who shot somebody, accidentally took over the Alexander Kohler persona, and then found Regina. They get married and have a kid, Bartosz. But in this origin world, we find out that Alexander and Regina never hooked up, never got married, possibly implying that the accident, which alt-world Alexander called it, was possibly caused by Cleflip 3. Because Alexander and Regina didn't hook up. There was no accident that sent Boris to Winden, apparently.
So in the end of the dinner party, Katerina toasts her one wish would be a world without Winden.
Which in Adam's world, that was something that we had heard an awful lot said by people saying, oh, a world without Winden. And Katerina is taking on right Ulrich's thoughts there.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to have a normal family dinner party, it seems weird to toast that your city, you wish it didn't exist. And of course, we're all laughing on the sidelines because they were a moment in time away from getting that wish come true.
So true, Tiny. Let's go further down these insane rabbit holes. So we see in this origin world, and you had to look for it over the treetops, there was no nuclear power plant. Which you would assume means in the origin world, the Cleflip 3 didn't beat up that city council member / mayor to get it approved so it would be built. So is that why Regina didn't have cancer and could live?
Oh, good point. Great point.
Also a terrible point if any listeners live near nuclear power plants. Okay, Tiny, on last week's podcast, you said you wanted to know something important. You were like, I want to know about Clausen, Task Force Clausen.
Right.
Is there any clue that you can tell as to who wrote the letter which told Task Force Clausen, if you're looking for your missing brother Alexander, look in Winden?
Well, not to me, Bubba, but I know that you are much more astute and have actually watched these episodes more than once. So what do you think?
I had to look this up online, and it's something that I misspoke in a previous podcast. I had said that Cleflip 3 is so much like Noah, and he was saying things that Noah had said, and I was like, that line that he said in the Tannhaus carriage when he was killing the blind Gustav Tannhaus in one of the early episodes of Season 3, Cleflip said a line, he who has eyes to see, ears to hear. And I thought, oh, I knew it. So I was like, oh, Noah must have said that in the past. But no, where we had heard the line, he who has eyes to see and ears to hear, that was actually in the letter sent to Clausen to look in Winden.
Wow.
So people online have theorized
that Cleft Lip 3.
Cleft Lip 3,
wow.
Whose job was to make sure everything happened so he could be born, so everything could happen as it was.
Selfish Cleft Lip 3.
This isn't one of my typical questions, Tiny, but Cleft Lip 3 got to meet his mother. We saw there.
That was very touching.
How would you feel? Now, think about this Alt Martha. She had probably, as I was thinking, she had probably just been impregnated by this Jonas a couple of days earlier. And now she's meeting her born child, three versions of him, and she gets a nice hug from possibly 8-year-old Cleft Lip 3.
Made an impression enough to shoot the love of your life. I mean, only a face a mother could love.
A lip only a mother could love. We know this is the last Wind and Caves podcast, but we want all the double T's.
Time travelers.
To stick with us and listen to some of our other podcasts and download some of our other podcasts. So right now we're going to play a game that we play on our Babylon Berlin Babel podcast. That is a podcast talking about, recapping, discussing another German television show here in the United States and various places in the world. You can see it on Netflix. In Europe, you have to look at Sky Atlantic for it, but it's a show called Babylon Berlin, and we talk about that, and it's a German language show almost, and this sounds ridiculous because there's no time travel or science fiction genre elements of that show, but it is somehow almost as confusing as Dark because there's so many various political sides and criminal sides. It's called Babylon Berlin. It's a great, great show, and it's a fun podcast, Babylon Berlin Babel, that we do. And we have a game on that show that we're going to play right now. And that game, in honor of this German heritage, it's called Who's the Worst? I'm going to give you some characters, and you're going to have to tell me who's the worst.
Got it.
All right, so we're going to go to the mother division. Who's the worst? So there's Helgi's mom, Greta Doppler. Greta Doppler is always kind of stern and terrible. We only see her in the 50s timeline. She reveals to Noah that she thinks that Helgi wasn't born of her husband, Bernd Doppler, but was a child created not by love. We see on Eva's floor that he was created by this character with a Russian name, possibly implying that Greta got raped or sexually assaulted by a Russian soldier in World War II. Anyway, she was a very mean mom, Helga's mom, Greta. Or is Katarina's mom the worst? Who beat her daughter constantly and then ended up killing her daughter because she thought she was an aborted baby come to life to haunt her. There's Jonas's mom, Hannah, who there are a lot of double H's.
Hannah haters.
Who never liked Hannah. We won't go through Hannah's crimes. Or is it Mikkel's adoptive mother, Inez, who apparently kept drugging him and helping him forget who he was. So let's hear it, Tiny. Who's the worst?
I'm going to go with Katarina's mom. It's very tough, but you know, she beat Katarina as her daughter and then killed Katarina when she thought she wasn't her daughter but her aborted baby
from hell.
I can't clear that one in my mind, so I'm gonna go with Katarina's mom.
I'm only playing devil's advocate. So Katarina's mom, I had to look online to find this out. We know we saw her at the abortion clinic where Hannah ran into her in the 50s. They say that Katarina's mom at that age was 12. Oh, to have something happen like that and be at an abortion clinic when you're 12, that would warp you forever. But that didn't make...
No, I don't. I don't forgive her.
All right, listeners, once again, at DoublePHQ on Twitter and Instagram, Facebook.com/DoublePHQ, YouTube, write those comments. Who's the worst, Wind and Mother? All right, Tiny, now it's time to go to the father division.
Oh, jeez.
Of Who's the Worst. Okay, Trante Nielsen. So Trante Nielsen cheated on his wife, Jana. He also didn't reveal to his son, Ulrich, now this is much older, Trante, that he found Mads' body and planted it somewhere. That's in Adam's world, the Brian world we've been focusing on, Trante Nielsen. There's Ulrich Nielsen. In both worlds, he is a terrible, unfaithful husband. And in the alt world, he seems to be a terrible father. He was asking Martha and Magnus, were you on anything when you found this body? And in both worlds, he beats poor Helgi what he thinks to death, but doesn't succeed in either world. So that's Ulrich. There's Egon Tiedemann. Is he a terrible father? He becomes, his wife leaves him and he becomes a drunk and unthoughtful. He cheated on his wife. And he definitely, until the very end, had a rough relationship with his daughter, Claudia. All right, how about this for the worst father division? Cleflip III, the father of Trante. And totally absent father, except for the one time they creeped him out when he was a little kid by the cave. There's the Adam, terrible father. Adam's child is Cleflip III. He keeps trying to kill him before he's born.
Apple doesn't fall from the tree, right?
And my final terrible father in the father division, this is a tricky one. Who ended up being Regina's father? Bernd Doppler. So now let's think about this. Bernd Doppler is Helga's father. Helga and his future sex partner, Claudia, are about the same age. You have to go online and you find out Bernd Doppler is 29 years older than Claudia. The way you almost have to read this, now there's a creepy scene here in season 3 where Claudia has come to tutor young Helga, and she seems to be about 12 or 13, and Bernd Doppler comes out and he says, oh, you're looking so adult, here's some money, more than you ask for. But then also, how about this? He was her boss at the nuclear power plant. Now, she does get to replace him, but is it possible she fooled around with her boss and her boss fooled around with her, and he's 29 years older than her. So, okay, that is some terrible fathers. I may even be forgetting some. Tiny, of the father division of Linden, who's the worst?
Well, here's the thing, Bubba, is you laid out a lot of crimes, but many of the crimes you laid out actually did not depict how bad a father they were. So Ulrich was a terrible husband.
I mean, in the alt world, he did blame his kids, you know?
I don't know. I think maybe absentee parent Adam would be the verse.
Well, the Cleflip III is also absentee, and he's not taking care of his son Trante in any world because he's too busy killing people, setting the time flying straight.
Because he was abandoned.
Oh, okay. Innocent Cleflip III. All right, Tiny, now I want to do a question now that's about the whole series. We've watched the whole series, 3 seasons of this mind-tripping show. What do you think was the biggest shock? Your biggest, oh my God, watching all 3 seasons. What was your biggest shock?
I don't think I ever duplicated the first shock of realizing that Michael was Mikkel.
It was that big, huh?
It was that big, and it set the table for the entire show.
I love it. I have a different answer. My different answer comes from season 2. Now, this show has had plenty of shocks, and I loved all the shocks, even if one in these 2 episodes we watched tonight horrified me, and that was what I'll call Stranger Adam killing his mother, Hannah. That was so shocking, so disturbing, in front of his sister as she was sleeping, Silja. So that was a terrible shock. But for me, the number one shock was in season 2, when suddenly we saw, oh, wait a minute. Ulrich has been stuck in the asylum all these years, and he was old man Ulrich, mainly because of things outside the show. In the first season, Ulrich, I described him as like the second lead behind Jonas. He was such a big part of that first season, and specifically that actor, middle-aged Ulrich. And the fact we got to season 2, and then it was like, he's not around, and he's suddenly become old man Ulrich. That was such a huge shock to me. There's so many others that I just can't even mention. Obviously, neither of us have mentioned the Charlotte is the daughter of the Elizabeth, who's the daughter of Charlotte, crazy switcheroo at the end of season 2. There's an alternate world shock, so many shocks. But for me, the biggest was like, oh my Lord, Ulrich is screwed in the home. That was, to me, the craziest shock of them all. One final question, and this can be for all 3 seasons as well. Who, now we know that most people, based on one ending, most people, their whole history is vanished and turned into dust. But of the people we saw, who suffered the worst fate? I'll go first. For me, the character who suffered the worst fate is Adam. Let's think about Adam / Jonas's fate. Jonas is a kid. He will assume he has a normal childhood until he's about 17, where he finally succeeds and hooks up with the girl of his dreams, Martha. That night, his dad commits suicide. He spends 3 months, I believe it was, in therapy and in counseling. He's getting drugged. He comes out of the therapy. He goes back to school. The very first night he's back at school, he discovers that his girlfriend Martha is now dating his best friend Bartosz. Then her little brother disappears when he was kind of the one watching him at the cave. Later on, he finds out that his father is Mikkel, and he dilly-dallies back and forth. But at the end of season one, he's like, you know what? Screw it. I'm going to go back in time, and I'm going to save my father, Mikkel, even if it means I don't exist. He gets thwarted in that because Helga and Noah kidnap him and throw him in the bunker. So then, okay. Then he gets thrown forward in time. He gets hung up, and he has to get saved from being shot. He's sent back and forth. All these things. He goes and he has a chance to stop his dad's suicide. So he failed at the chance to stop his dad from going back in time to become his dad. He's like, okay, now I'm going to stop my dad's suicide. No, I can't stop my dad's suicide. I'm the cause of it. Then the love of his life, Martha, gets shot. Then, if that wasn't enough, and we'll follow the one who went down into the basement, then he spends the next 32 years trapped trying to create a time machine so he can go back in time. First, he's like, okay, I'm going to go back in time. I'm going to close the gap and stop the tunnel from being used for time travel so it won't, nothing will ever have happened. He fails at that. Then he's like, all right, I'm going to kill Adam and I'm going to save Martha. He fails at both of those. Then we see all the things that happened to him there in episode 7. Jonas's fate, the worst fate.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I can argue with that. I mean, there's definitely characters I feel bad for. For some reason, I don't think it's the worst fate or the worst path. But, you know, Charlotte just sticks with me. Your mom is your daughter, and you live with the clockmaker. Again, it's not to the same level as Jonas.
Your husband, who you have two children with that you love, your husband has urgings and may not have ever been totally into you.
Yeah.
So that is a
tough
thing.
I don't know. She just seemed like somebody I felt sorry for. But it's not that she's had the same plight is Jonas at all.
Okay. Listeners, who do you think has suffered the worst fate? Tell us, let us know. We're going to be talking about this show as long as people are listening to Winning Caves podcast. One final bit of thing before we break into these episodes and cover them as best we can. They're so twisty and turny. I want you to tell me, Hannah. Sorry, I want you to tell me.
What?
I want you to tell me, Tiny. We're going to go to Jonas, and I'm going to see if you can figure out how he is related to these various characters. So what is his relationship to Hannah? What is Jonas's relationship to Hannah?
Hannah is his mother.
As well as his great-great-great-great-grandmother.
Okay. Of course.
So 50% there, Tidy. Very good. All right, Tidy. Silja Tiedemann. What is Jonas's relation to Silja?
So half-sister.
Correct. And she is his half-sister. She's also his great-great-great-grandmother.
Got it.
All right. How about this? Cleflip 3. What is his relationship with Cleflip 3?
Proud father.
Well, no. Yeah, he's the father, right? And then what else? Cleflip 3 is his son. He's also his great-great-grandfather.
Of course.
All right. How about a character that the one thing about these final two episodes, I really did come to be okay with Bartosz. So what is the relationship between Jonas and Bartosz?
Brother-in-law.
That's one of them. Great. Bartosz is his brother-in-law as well as his great-great-great-grandfather. Oh, wait. One final one. Jonas's relationship to Martha, what is it?
Aunt, obviously.
Correct, and? She is his great-great-granddaughter.
Of course.
Listeners, some of these are absolutely incredible. So, like, Egon is Jonas's great-great-great-great-grandfather and his great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather. Good work, Egon. All right, so let's get to this. We are going to try to go through all these crazy things. We're going to start in Eva's world, Tiny, and you stop me whenever you hear anything crazy.
Okay.
So in Eva's world in 1986, Alt Ulrich followed Alt Old Helga out of the cave. Ulrich found the middle-aged Alt Helgi, beat him up. We saw that the eye got destroyed in this world instead of the ear. He drags him down into the bunker. No, this bunker, the Alt bunker, has yellow wallpaper with those characters instead of blue wallpaper with those characters. Then Alt Old Helgi sneaks up behind him and kills him with a crowbar. Oh, feel any sympathy for either of these characters who kept tormenting each other, Helga or Ulrich?
Nah, it was, you know, again, it's, you know, third verse, same as the first. You've seen that before in a different way.
Okay, 2019, Eva's world. Alt Martha and Stranger Martha go in to confront younger Alt Martha and Jonas. And Alt Martha, we see why she shot and killed Jonas. Any thoughts on that? Were you happy that she killed him so that her sons could live?
The Clef I think it made me understand the scene a lot better. I mean, but that was a quick turnaround.
Oh, it was.
I was like, oh, here's your kids, and then, you know, go in and change. That was part of. Mm-hmm. You know, she had to change, which was weird, get into costume to come out to be distinguishable from the one that was about to walk in.
Right. That's exactly right. That's why they did put her in a new costume. Okay, how about this? Also in Alt 2019, Adam brought Jonas to Eva's world. Now, this was the third version of Jonas, the one who wasn't saved by Alt Martha at the apocalypse, the one who didn't run down into the basement in the apocalypse. This was the third version. Adam brought Jonas to Eva's world. And Jonas had to save Alt Martha from going with old Magnus and Francisca, and he had to run and grab her and zap her away. I loved that scene. It was tense. I thought it was fun.
I thought it was great. It reminded me of, you know, Save the Clock Tower. I mean, he hit it right on the nose of when that little bulb was going to go off.
I loved that, too. But then the one thing about that scene that I wish had happened, we never got to find out what Magnus and Francisca thought of it. They had been sent there by Adam, old Adam, and like, okay, you got to get Alt Martha and have her save Jonas. And then suddenly, Jonas comes and steals her away from what you're supposed to do.
Well, it gets back to the cat. In one world, the cat is alive, and in the other world, the cat has been poisoned.
Hell yeah, Tiny, you figured it out. So good. Adam, in Alt 2019, while Jonas is doing this stuff, Adam has gone to her lair, and he set her paintings on fire. We always thought maybe the apocalypse had done that to the Adam and Eve painting. No, it was Adam doing it. Then he entered Eva's God particle, and he traveled into the future. Now, before we get there in the alt-world 2040, Claudia, this was a scene I loved, Claudia impersonated alt-Claudia to enter Eve's lair. I thought that was so good.
It was super fun. It was smart on her part, and it really showed what I think we should have followed all along, but became clear with this move, is that she's the smartest player of everybody.
We should have always been on Team Claudia, even if we didn't know. Like I pointed out, the showrunners seemed to be on Team Claudia. Heck yeah. Now, also around this time in Alt 2040, or Eva's World 2040, Alt Bartos brought Alt Martha, these are young versions of them, to Eva, and then Eva slashed Alt Martha, a.k.a. her own face. Oh, dang, was that crazy? You'll remember which side you're on.
Yeah, because you'll look at the scar I just put on your face. That makes no sense.
Also, we assume around 2040 in Eva's world, that's where, once again, Alt Martha met the Clef Lip 3. This was so crazy, and it somehow, are we supposed to feel sad for Clef Lip 3 that he never had a bomb until now? Oh.
Yeah, it was just felt really cringy, almost awkward. They needed some better soundtrack behind it, the reunion music to feel it. I wasn't emotionally in the moment of Martha reuniting with her children.
Children, plural, meaning child, singular. Yeah, you know, Tiny, we are here recording this in 2020, the year of the pandemic, COVID-19, and it's really breaking my heart because I want to find a kid and an old man and go as Clef Lip 3 for Halloween.
That would be really funny.
Right, it would be good to go as those three. Okay, so we're done somehow, some way. Oh, well, no. Final scene that happens in Eva's world is that Eva is there. She's waiting for Adam to come and kill her. which apparently has happened multiple times. Adam walks in, but there aren't any bullets in the gun, and Eva and Adam seem to come to an impasse and then turn to dust together. Do you feel any emotion in that scene when Eva realized that Adam wasn't going to kill her like she expected?
I don't know. I was just playing through. You know, Adam asked Claudia, have we done this before? And
right.
She said, you know, all of these other things have happened infinite times, but this moment is happening for the first time. So it just made me think, how did Martha know that at that moment, I guess in infinite moments, he's done the same thing, but when Adam asked Claudia that question, he wasn't aware that the things had happened infinite times. So it made me question why she was aware this had happened infinite times. And when he was with Claudia, he wasn't aware some things had happened over and over again.
It seems weird. Like, how would you even know? How could you ever know that things had happened multiple times to yourself? Like, you could see other people doing various things multiple times. But how? Yeah. Oh, boy.
Listen. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah,
it's
no, I
hard.
Totally.
Like,
yeah.
You know, they both recognized it when they were together, but he didn't recognize it when Claudia was telling,
right,
showing him through the thing. And it was just really funny. I don't, you know, this is, you know, when Claudia walks him in, like, oh, this is all, you know, like, it was just going to be heartbreak for him to see his lair completely burnt up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, let's get then to Adam's world. In Adam's world, we spend so much time in. It's what we had been calling the Prime World, but now we're going to try to call it Adam's world. And this, almost all of episode 7, not entirely, but almost all of episode 7 was in Adam's world. Chronologically, 1890, Stranger Jonas and the crew have been trapped there for 2 years. They're trying to get the God particle to work, and we see Adam get zapped, what we assume the first of many injuries that turned Stranger Jonas into Adam. Yuck. Bartos is broken. He knows about the apocalypse, obviously, but he has come to realize, you know what, Stranger Jonas's intention isn't to stop the apocalypse. And Stranger Jonas admits it. No, he wants to find the origin and destroy the origin. And that is Stranger Jonas's version of paradise. Bartosz is really upset. He goes out in the rain. Once again, no umbrellas ever exist in any world on Winden. When suddenly, who shows up from far in the future? Wearing the clothes she had told Alt Martha to take off in a previous episode, it's Silja, the character we had been calling
Scarface.
Scarface. She shows up at that exact moment that Bartosz is walking through those rainy woods. It's love at wet sight. Tiny question for you. Did Silja, who had met old Bartosz when she was a kid and then been taken forward to the future, did Silja know that, hey, get in the God particle, you're going to go back to 1890 and you're going to hook up with this guy and have 2 kids? Did she know this was going to happen? Because she had never met that version of Bartosz before. Or was it just a happy accident that she went back in time and met Bartosz? What do you think? She was sent there for a purpose from Adam, but did she know the purpose?
I don't know if she knew the purpose, but she did certainly didn't. She didn't look like she was out of place. She looked like she was ready for Bartosz.
That's right. We jump ahead to 1904. So then the crew has been stuck there 16 years, and she gives birth with the help of Erna, who we had met in season 2, to a baby. Bartosz is there. And they're like, well, what do you want to name? You've had a son. What do you want to name it? And she says, Hanno. Hanno. Ha. No. No. Does Bartosz at that time realize that his wife has just given birth to Noah? What do you think?
He doesn't seem to. I don't know.
He doesn't.
I don't think so.
But we jump forward to 1910. The crew has been now stuck there 22 years. Silja dies giving birth to a daughter that she wanted to name Agnes. When Bartosz hears the name Agnes, has he put it together that, wait a minute, I've given birth to Noah and Agnes? Does he realize it? Because he does have a big shock kind of look on his face at that point.
It's hard for me to know if his shock look is that his wife just died or that Noah is his kid.
Yes, that would be a weird feeling for him because his kid got him into time travel to begin with. In the original season,
right,
it's Noah,
right,
who introduces Bartosz to time travel, introduces his young father to time travel. Then, of course, as we know, it's young Noah, who ends up killing his father in 1922. Oh boy, this is so crazy. We won't go too deep.
Complicated. Worst father award maybe should be thrown in.
Well, that would be worst son because
worst
he killed
son,
his father.
Worst son, right?
Got his dad involved in time travel and then killed his dad. Terrible Hano/Noah. We've never liked that guy, even though this episode kind of made me feel sorry for him at times too. Let's jump ahead to 1911. The crew has been stuck in this time frame 23 years. Eva has contacted Hannah, told her to go to Jonas with her daughter, his half-sister Silja. The clothes and hair that Hannah and Silja are wearing, to me it looks like maybe this was the 1960s or 1970s they had spent their time in. It's tough to tell. But anyway, Bartosz sees the love of his life as a child. Whoops, because she has that scar on her face. But then Hannah sees what has happened to her son, Jonas. And at this point, I'm not calling him Stranger Jonas. I'm calling him Stranger Adam. Oh, yuck. And then when he killed her, for me, I was like, oh, Lord, that's
I really
terrible.
Didn't even understand why he did that. And I also don't understand why she was sent there.
I think she was sent there. Well, I almost want to leave Hannah out of this. Eva sent Silja to Jonas Stranger Adam because, boy, that's a good question. Well, Stranger Adam knows when he sees Silja, he's like, wait a minute, this is the little kid version of the girl I met when I was a teen in 2053, the girl who butted me in the face and said, welcome to the future, and then helped me enter the God Particle and go through my crazy adventures. So Stranger Adam knows that Silja has got to end up there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's possible that if Hannah had slept through him taking Silja, he wouldn't have killed her. What do you think? He's just terrible at this point, Stranger Adam. Oh.
Yeah, I think he just really is unclear about the path that he thought he needed to keep.
Yeah. Oh, let's go to 1920. So now it's officially Adam. Noah has traveled back in time from the post-apocalypse to 1920. He goes and gets a room at Erna's because he remembered from when he was a kid that Erna rented rooms. And then he sees a younger version of himself, Hannah. Oh, crazy. He goes to see Adam. Adam blames Claudia for Noah's missing daughter, Charlotte. And he says, you got to find those missing pages. They'll lead you to your final destination. He says, Helga will help you with this. And he gives Noah a Bible, turning him into, I assume, the priest he's going to become. Is Adam fully aware of everything that's going to happen at that point? Because it sure seems like he is. But the way I read it is that Adam hasn't yet been responsible for baby Charlotte being taken. So you think he's just blaming Claudia so Noah's anger will be directed at her?
No, I think he has no idea. He comes across to me like he has no idea.
Interesting. You would think at a certain point these people would realize that, okay, you may not be the reason that this terrible thing might infant daughter Charlotte was taken now, but you could be in the future, but just not to be.
Right.
Okay, so in 1986, Jonas has taken Alt Martha to his area. They're alive. They go to the cave. They are going to enter the Matrix, I like to call it. There are always glitches in the Matrix. They're in the tunnel in Adam's world when in the origin world, Tannhaus is creating his machine. We spent a brief moment in 2020 at the apocalypse where we saw loop one, where Alt Martha saves Jonas from the apocalypse. We saw loop two, where Alt Bartosz stops Alt Martha from saving Jonas, and then Jonas runs down into the basement. And then we saw this new version, loop three, where Adam saves Jonas from the apocalypse. Did you like seeing the third world? Tiny, all this time I've been talking about a third world.
Oh, here we go. Bubba wants to have the record show.
Well, I was right about a third world, so I can't say that. But I always thought it would be created by them doing the right thing. Not that they were created from this third world. So I'm only giving myself partial credit. But were you happy to see a third world?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think I couldn't imagine another version of these characters. But I think with the diagram, it makes sense that there was a third world. I still don't understand why, you know, everything in Jonas is Jonas and Martha's fault. I mean, it doesn't seem like it's their fault that these worlds were created. It seems like it's Tannhaus's fault.
Right.
On why they say, but people talk about it's their fault that they exist. And so, I don't know. I don't think it's necessarily their fault. Maybe it's their fault that they perpetuated it over and over and over again.
I love that take, Tiny. That's how I would read it as well. In Adam's World 2021, so this is right after the apocalypse, we see Noah and Elizabeth unblocking the tunnel, but of course it's Noah, it's not open anymore. Noah still believes in Adam's prophecy. This is young Noah and young Elizabeth. They're going to see paradise, free of pain and sorrow. Any pain ever felt is erased. And that is what they got. Do you feel that's a good paradise? You know, that any pain and sorrow, they were free of it, and any pain they ever felt was erased.
I mean, in retrospect, I feel like it was the only possible outcome.
Okay. In 2023, so now this is 3 years after the apocalypse in Adam's world, Jonas and Claudia have been working on the God particle for 3 years, but there's a chance that Claudia is stalling him based on information she was getting from Alt-Claudia at this time. They don't have any luck. Jonas is broken. He goes to his house. He goes to the room where his father, Mikkel Michael, killed himself. Jonas tries to hang himself, but he's saved by young Noah. Young Noah is pissed because old Adam made him a promise. You can't kill yourself. Noah didn't learn that lesson when he tried to kill Adam later. Time won't permit it. Any thoughts about young Noah saving Jonas?
Didn't look like it was a saving act. I mean, he went there kind of as self-motivated interest for sure. I mean, I thought about poor Adam's/Jonas's neck, torn up time after time.
Yeah, terrible. So then we jump forward 20 years post the apocalypse. Jonas, Noah, Claudia, they've been stuck there. They're now played by the middle-aged actors. And this was the first time I really thought, oh my goodness, Stranger Jonas actor really does look like a much older version of young Jonas. I thought that was great. I thought it was perfect. By this point, Noah has been suspecting Claudia, doesn't want it to work. Claudia has been disappearing for days, we hear, obviously meaning she's been going to the alt world. And Elizabeth, at this point, is now the older Elizabeth. She's pregnant. In front of Regina's grave, Claudia tells Tronte that for a long time she had wished he was Regina's father, but he isn't. Regina, therefore, isn't tied to this knot that we got to break. Claudia tells Tronte to go back in time and end the suffering of Regina.
So does she figure this out? I mean, how did all her time travels make her figure out that Tronte was not the father?
I wonder if she always knew it, but for some reason in the alt world was smart enough to never let Eva know about it. Mm-hmm. And then it didn't seem to be Adam was that concerned about Regina in Adam's world. So that would be my only thought about it. But as long as Regina wasn't tied to the knot,
she could live.
She could live. But she wasn't living in the alt world, and she had died. And she already knew that she had died in the what we had been calling the prime world, Adam's world. So she makes a decision. I need something to motivate me to break this knot. Tronte, go end my daughter's suffering and kill her. Oh, tough decision. In Adam's world, 2040... Claudia and Alt-Claudia have a powwow, and I love this. Claudia is questioning Alt-Claudia about Eva's plan and everything. But my favorite part, Claudia asks Alt-Claudia, did you ever meet my older self, old white devil Claudia? And when Alt-Claudia says no, then Claudia knows, okay, I can kill you. And this sounds ridiculous. When Claudia shot and killed Alt-Claudia, I loved it. I was like, yeah, all right. And she says this line, why did my older version say if this works, Regina will live? She hadn't lived in either world. I love that. It got me back on Team Claudia. I was like, oh, hell yes. In 2041, 21 years post-apocalypse, Noah and Elizabeth have had their baby. They leave their baby Charlotte in their little camper, in their trailer, when who sneaks in and takes her? Old Charlotte and old Elizabeth, just as Lamb predicted last week. Incredible, Tiny.
I know. Our guest coming up with the perfect predicted outcome is unbelievable. And I think this is what you were getting to before about, you know, humanizing Noah a little bit. It was pretty devastating when their baby was gone.
Just a little bit, though. Let's not give him too much credit.
No, no.
Now, one crazy thing in this, listeners, I'll try to keep straight. Noah in 2041 grabs the notebook with the triquetra, the Trinity cross, on the cover. How did they have that notebook? Well, White Devil Claudia had given it to Peter at the end of season one, who then, post-apocalypse, must have left it so Elizabeth had it. Then Noah took it. Noah kept it for the theoretically for the end of time, or end of his time, looking for those missing pages, which Claudia had ripped out right after she sent Stranger Jonas back to see the beginning of season one. Oh boy, let's not even go too much crazy in that. 2052, White Devil Claudia tells Stranger Jonas that, okay, I'm going to send you back in time. This time it's going to work, which is a complete lie. It's not going to work. He thinks it's going to work, and that's why we saw Stranger Jonas do the things he did in season one. But she also tells him, Jonas, you must never give up hope. Why do you think she said that? Because Adam at times, if he hasn't given up hope, he's become just a monster.
I don't know. I mean, I don't think anybody's given up hope. The way they act, running around, trying to keep things going or stop them from happening. I mean, they all seem super motivated with their agenda. So I don't know if they've ever given up hope.
2053 in Adam's world, he has hit Alt Martha with the God particle with the power of two apocalypses. He has destroyed the origin. He's broken the knot, but he's kind of looking around and like, why am I still here? He realizes it didn't work, and in walks White Devil Claudia. You don't have no idea how the game is played, you moron. And so she explains it, sets it straight. When time stands still, which is at this apocalypse, things can change. Eva had been using it to always thwart Adam's attempts to destroy any version of the origin, aka Cleflip 3 and Alt Martha. Now Adam has it and Claudia has it, and they're going to stop the disaster in the origin world. If it all works, Regina will live. And I love this one little moment. Claudia told White Devil Claudia, apologize to Dad. Tell him she's sorry. Which we saw in season two.
Yeah, yeah. That was sad. I guess she just never shook that.
In the origin world, now this was something I didn't notice. I had to go online and read it. Do you realize when we were in the origin world, Tiny, things weren't reversed like they had, which they distinguished between Adam and Eva's world about. In the origin world, there was a different aspect ratio. There was more letterboxing on the top and the bottom
Bubba,
of the screen.
I didn't notice it at all.
But that's how you could tell, listeners, if you go watch any scenes in the origin world, they'll have deeper letterboxing to let you know you're in the origin world.
Yeah, the message received, not, I didn't notice that at all. But that's why everybody listens to the Wind and Caves podcast.
Hashtag Wind and Caves podcast, people. We love it. So, okay, there's too much craziness to go on. But in one version of that world, in 1971, Tannhaus's son Merrick, his daughter-in-law Sonia, and their granddaughter Charlotte die. In 74, starts building a time machine, puts it in the bunker. The first time I saw these actions happen in episode 7, I knew there was something odd because the bunker door now kind of lifted up rather than opening to the right or left.
I did notice that.
I noticed there was something weird. And what was also weird is we saw in 1986 that HG was building this time machine in the bunker. And I kind of thought, well, wait a minute. No. In 1986, it's Noah and Helgi in the blue wallpaper doing their stuff. So I kind of could tell there was something going on, but it wasn't until, obviously, White Devil Claudia wised me up, too, that we could see it all happen. In the second loop of the Infinity Symbol in the origin world, Merrick is fighting with his father about taking over the clock store and how his father, HG, has always ignored him. They drive down the road when suddenly Jonas and Martha appear in front of them. Jonas originally tries to be logic, like, hey, the bridge is closed, you gotta turn
around. For a minute, I thought Jonas and Martha were gonna be the ones driving them off the road.
I did too. When they swerved, I thought, oh my goodness,
yeah.
They've caused the problem.
And then their car was in the middle of the intersection. I thought, oh gosh, Jonas keeps, the more he tries, the more he makes everything the same.
But they did appeal to his feelings. They appealed to his love, even though it was strained and frayed, his love for his father. They returned to the shop. Alt Martha asks Jonas, did it work? Jonas talks about seeing her as a child. And once again, she says, oh, yeah, I remember that. Are we a dream? They turn to dust as Jonas tells her, you and I are perfect for each other. Never believe anything else. The end. Happy? Glad? Excited?
I like an end or a beginning, but I like that. I thought it was good. I did notice just, you know, Bubba's always noticing everything, but he hasn't mentioned this. I did notice that when they were in the lights and Martha saw young Jonas, he was wearing a yellow raincoat. I was thinking, man, that kid is... Love some yellow raincoats.
Well, how about Alt Martha? Bangs her whole life.
Exactly.
From a kid to Eva, bangs.
Never
one hairstyle.
Out of style. Yeah.
Okay. Listeners, it's time for your feedback. We're going to start off by hearing from our friends from Geek Girls Who.
Hello, Bubba and Tiny. This is Susan, and I'm here to answer a few questions about Dark. I don't know if I'm qualified, but hey, why not? So I started watching Dark a few weeks before season 3 came out, and I had tried to watch it when it first came out, but I had just had surgery, and it was just too hard to focus on it and keep track of everything. I think I watched like part of the first episode or maybe the whole first episode, and it was just too much back then, so it took a pandemic. Okay, the worst mother. Well... Yeah, Katarina's mom abused her and later killed her. She was pretty bad. Then we have Hannah. She's not the best person or not the best role model. And then she was murdered by her son. So that's pretty bad too. But I did love her little smile at the end. Helga's mom, she was another abuser. Inez was drugging Mikkel, and so, yeah, none of the moms are great. Katarina herself, when she was a mom, she kind of checked out, but, you know, I understand that because her child and her husband were missing, and so she was focused on them instead of the two children who were still there. So, but I'd have to say the award here, it goes to Hannah. She was the worst mother. For the fathers, let me see. Well, there was Tronte. He was not great because he taught Ulrich everything he knew, right? So, and then Ulrich was another bad father. He was a bad husband also, and, you know, like Hannah, a terrible role model for his children. Then there's Egon. He was pretty clueless. And I kind of felt sorry for him. He was pretty much the absent papa. So, I don't know. He was not a good father either. But I think the award has to go to H.G. Tannhaus. Because he is the father of the worlds that we were following. And look how they turned out, right? So... That's my answer, H.G. Tannhaus, for being the father of the Dark Worlds. The biggest shock, it was exactly that, finding out that there was a third origin world that are the two that we've been watching so far had come from. I think when I found that out, I threw my hands up, and it was just... It was too much, but thankfully it was near the end of the series, so I kept watching. So, yeah, I don't know what I would have done if that were, like, you know, in the beginning of a season or something, you know. That's it. The biggest shock was that finding out that there was a third world that was an origin of the other two that we'd been watching. Who suffered the worst fate? I got to go with a controversial choice here again, right? So I would have to say Egon because he was just so clueless and stupid and closed-minded about everything. So he suffered from it because, you know, people tried to tell him what was going on. He didn't believe them. He's like, nope, that's not true. Everything was just so black and white for him. If he had maybe tried to understand a little bit more, I mean, he understood maybe a little bit. He saw what was going on in 2019, but then it was too late. Then he's just like looking back on his whole life with regrets. You know, if only I had seen this back in 1953 or in, you know, 1986, then if only this, then that. He would have been able to change some things, and who knows. So I think Egon suffered the worst. Thanks, guys, for doing the podcast. I've really enjoyed it. It's helped me keep track of things, because even though I'm not recovering from surgery and on pain meds and everything, you know, I still had trouble wrapping my mind around a lot of this, and you guys helped. So thanks for doing the podcast.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much. That's
Thank you, guys.
All right. Time for some feedback. Tiny, we have an awful lot of feedback. Let's see how we can do. Read this first one from Twitter.
All right. On Twitter, it's Stacey E. Walker at SC Walker AT. Loved it, but would have liked to seen more of Agnes's story as well as a bit more of her history with Claudia. Hashtag Wind and Caves podcast entered in our drawing.
Woohoo, thank you. So did you feel like we needed more from Agnes? I have to be honest, Stacey, I did feel like we needed more of Agnes. We saw her get in the God Particle, I want to say, in like episode 3 or 4 of season 3, and we never knew where she went. Now, there could be some thoughts, well, maybe she was going to have the child with, that go to have Cleflip 3, go to be with him and have the child Tronte, but the way it all played out, it felt like she had already done that. So, yeah, I do have a question about Agnes.
She seems like a really interesting character. I mean, she shoots her own brother to not have more information on. I agree with that.
There's something going on with her, because another thing that about Agnes is both Adam and Claudia gave her a newspaper of saying, hey, this is the obituary of White Devil Claudia's death. Give this to younger Claudia when it's time. She got it from two different people, so it's interesting to see about good old Claudia. We also got a tweet from, I hope I get this pronounced, Prudvi? Is that Prudy? Prud, how would you pronounce that?
Prudhivi.
Prudhivi. All right, so we hope so. It's at Procrastinator. I love that Twitter handle. Love
P-R-U, Procrastinator.
I love it. They wrote, since we are showing a lot of interest in Dark, and in general, German TV shows, let me tell you, the best German TV show on Netflix is still hashtag Babylon Berlin. Hey, trust me, listen to our podcast on it. Good way to self-promote there, Procrastinator. We love it.
What should Procrastinator hashtag for the Babylon Berlin podcast?
Hashtag Babylon Berlin Babble. Once again, if you like German television shows that you got to focus on, Babylon Berlin's a really good one. That one, I'll say, though, that show, the dubbing is terrible. I know, Tiny, you and I have talked about how we use the dubbing on Dark, and some listeners hate the dubbing on Dark, but it helps us better comprehend the show rather than having to read. The dubbing on Babylon Berlin was so terrible that I have always gone German language with English subtitles on that one. How about this next bit of feedback we got from Dooley's Left Leg on Twitter?
Dooley's Left Legs. I'm writing from the past. I can't listen yet, or maybe I already did. I lost interest first time around. I'm watching it with subtitles, much better, up to the start of season 2, episode 4. Hopefully I'll be back in your time to enjoy the final 2 podcasts. My head's hurting definitely. Lost. Feel to time.
Wow, Lost as in the TV show Lost. Tiny, you always said you were a big fan of Lost. Comparing those twisty, brain-numbing shows, Dark certainly is a lot more complicated than Lost, but Lost has some fun, right?
You know, I do like Lost, and it's funny, and as weird as it sounds, the end of Dark reminded me a little bit of the end of Lost, in that we're going away, but we're okay with it. Kind of a peacefulness to it. I saw a parallel there.
Also on Twitter, we just got a real nice note from at Michael J. Corsi, who wrote, great recap podcast for a badass show. Thank you so much.
Thanks, MJC. All right. Also, Vikesh at V-I-C-K-E-S-H. Great pod. Just FYI, the guy who plays young Peter is older Peter's son in real life. Cool.
I know. Now, this was because on the last podcast, we were talking about it. I said, boy, at certain angles, this guy looks like identical to older Peter. Turns out the actor was his son. And, of course, we got this exact same note from somebody else.
Flip in the burn down my she shed at Up Guntha. says, the reason that both Peters look so familiar is because they are real-life father and son. Hashtag Wind and Caves. Bubba, we are the last to know, and we are the hosts of the Wind and Caves podcast.
Listen, we love, love, love listeners who give us notes. Oh, I should see. Stacy gave us another note saying that she really liked guest Lamb last week. Oh, thank you so
Shout
much,
Shout out
Stacy.
To Lamb.
Holly at Holly Hunt Panson, true great double L.
Loyal listener.
On Twitter, wrote her feelings about season 3, and overall she wrote, overall they did a great job of tying up the story. Or untying, severing, I don't know. I only regret that we spent so much time focused on Martha and Jonas and not our other favorite characters. I would have liked a lot more Egon and even more Claudia. I'll always hate Hannah. Oh.
Hannah hater.
Holly is a Triple H. Holly hates Hannah. Oh, man. So good. Once again, we love, love, love our loyal listeners.
Peter at BAGGA 2007. Is Dark the best ever TV series? Must be close to it. Listen to Wind and Caves podcast, which is the best Dark podcast out there.
Oh, thank you so much, Peter.
Thanks, Peter.
Best series ever. It's darn good, let's be honest. It's really good with what it wants to do. It accomplishes. I don't know if it's the best ever. I don't know if it's my favorite ever, but Dark, it deserves some consideration.
The best TV series ever. Peter has forgot about Cheers. It's awkward.
Well, he may be not as old as some stuff. Tiny, aging us a bit. Maybe he's got to go back in time to 86 to watch Cheers, maybe there, Tiny.
All right, on YouTube, Michael J. Cox says, hey, Bubba, Tiny, and Lamb, never expected to find such an eclectic podcast, even though the show would probably say otherwise. Nevertheless, I treasure the connections this German show from Netflix has provided. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Michael. That's wonderful. This next bit of feedback from YouTube, I love it because this person on YouTube comments, Chan G, they were leaving comments on all of our recaps. It felt like they were watching and leaving comments on all of them. So I'll read a couple, then you read a couple from Chan G, Tiny. Chan G first wrote, I love your approach to analysis since it's focused on the character's moral traits and Netflix viewers' feelings towards them. Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I guess we haven't talked too much about, is there any character whose moral was just despicable? I mean, even Clef Lip 3, you could find a way to say he's not just saving his own life.
He loved his mother.
Right.
And his future and past self.
Right, but he's not just saving his own life. He's preserving everybody's life, yeah. Theoretically, Clef Lip 3. But, you know, he's not going to, once again, great Halloween costume, not great party guest. Also, Chan G, when we were talking back in season 1 about the best slap, he left a comment on that podcast where he said, the best slap was Bratty Martha getting smacked, but I wish it was Katarina smacking Hannah. Oh, that never really happened. She beat up young Hannah in the 80s in season 3, but never happened.
Yeah, and then Chan G continues, Bubba called it, Helgi has a crush on Regina.
I think he means Claudia, but yes.
Also, best three generational actor matches are Ulrich and Nurse Inez. Ulrich.
I know. I mean, incredible. I also do think Nurse Inez. I think the child one, it's always kind of easy to do, especially that young. You know, it was teenage Ulrich as opposed to Inez. We really saw her as a little girl, and they just put that they put that mole on her. But the middle-aged and older version of Nurse Inez, to me, they really did look alike. Oh, this is great. Chanji wrote his best two generational, meaning we only saw two generations of them, was Katarina, Egon, and Yana. Well, now, technically, we did see three versions of Yana, and I thought they were all pretty good. Egon was pretty good. That's right. You know, young Egon put on a lot of weight to become older Egon, but he was an alcoholic, and sure, okay. He wrote Alt-World Mute. Oh, this is one you may not like, Tiny. Chanji wrote Alt-World Mute Francisca is more likable opposed to First World and created obnoxious.
I like Francisca. I think she's likable in both. I mean, she's... Anyway, I'm not going to go to battle with Chanji. He gave us a nice compliment.
I know, this is true. Okay, he wrote, Mrs. Doppler, a.k.a. Helga's mom Greta, was super creepy and cold. She would have been a good character to delve into in season 2. And, get this, he believes a good romantic match for the Clef Lip 3. Although it appeared, and I agree with this, GNG, it did appear that she almost had some feelings for Noah there in the 50s. Now, I do want to say, I've been so tough on this Helga's mom, Greta Doppler, on the show. I went to IMDb, and I was looking at all these actors. And on the show, she is stern and kind of not very attractive. But on IMDb, when you saw her in life, real life, I was like, oh, this actress who plays Greta is really, really pretty. I was impressed. Oh, here we go. Chan-ji says, I really like Noah and Jonas, although they are so different. Weird, right? What do you think about that? Is it possible to watch this show and like both Noah and Jonas?
No, Chan-ji, that's totally weird. You're not supposed to like Noah.
And we got a review on iTunes. Listeners, this is how you entered into the contest. So, Tiny, read this 5-star review from Cannot Delete Kudos.
All right. Great companion podcast for dark fans is the title. Insightful and funny. These podcasters add a lot to the watching experience. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Cannot Delete Kudos. Everybody, even if you won't be eligible, future listeners, to enter a contest to win this A Journey Through Time novel, which we gave away at the beginning of this podcast, please, we definitely need reviews, especially on iTunes/Apple Podcasts. It's the way they put engagement with podcasts in search results. So when you search for Dark or other things, they tend to pop up in search results, the ones with the most viewer engagement. So that means reviews. Please give it to us. All right, Tiny, you ready for the rest of my crazy theory on Dark?
Let's hear it.
Question for you. When we looked at the carving of the family trees on Eva's floor, there's one line of the floor that I want you to help me out with. H.G. Tannhaus is there, and there's a line connecting him with Charlotte Doppler because he's her adoptive grandfather in both Eva's world and Adam's world. But it goes further up or further back in time, however you want to describe it, in the Tannhaus line. It shows H.G.'s father. It shows his grandfather, Gustav, the blind character that we saw a couple times in Season 3. And it shows us Gustav's father, who we saw in one scene in Season 3, Heinrich Tannhaus. And so I was wondering, why is the Tannhaus family on Eva's floor? You know, why are those guys in it? Now, we know that they did create Sigmundus, we know, in Adam's world, and maybe they did the same thing in Eva's world. But why, if they really aren't time travel people, why are they on Eva's floor? Any guess?
Well, I mean, they were interacting with Jonas and all of them in 1880-something.
Gustav was, right? But his father wasn't. His father, Heinrich,
wasn't. That's a good question. So do you have a theory around it?
Well, let's go further. I got one more question to lead into my theory, Tiny. So why, now, the Cleft Lip Three kill Gustav Tannhaus, and they kill him, and they take that pocket watch that says for Charlotte, and they take a copy of the Ariadne play. And I was thinking to myself, you know, I understand why the Cleft Lip Three were doing a lot of things. But why did they need that specific stopwatch and specific copy of Ariadne's play? Now, the answer could be, well, it was always that version of the stopwatch, and it was always that version of the play. But why specifically that one? And that's where my crazy theory begins.
Let's hear it.
In the versions of Adam's world and Eva's world, H.G.'s son, daughter-in-law, and grandchild are in an accident that puts them in the river, right? We're told from H.G. when he tells Charlotte in 1987, he says, you know, they never found my granddaughter Charlotte's body. So I began to think to myself, they never found his granddaughter's body. Why would they leave that fact in? It seems, you know, it's interesting, but it is irrelevant because his granddaughter Charlotte was not the Charlotte we knew. But he kept saying, they never found my granddaughter's body. And so who is Gustav Tannhaus's mother? Heinrich's wife, it's a woman named Charlotte. So I was thinking to myself, well, huh, is it possible that after Charlotte, old Charlotte, and old Elizabeth bring baby Charlotte to H.G. Tannhaus, that somehow they save his granddaughter? Because they, you know, they're not Adam, they're not really that evil. Why would you let all of these people die? And I thought to myself, well, maybe is there any way that H.G.'s granddaughter, they got brought back in time to be Heinrich's wife and Gustav Tannhaus's mother? Why would that be, you know, why would you do that? Well, that would, at the very least, explain why those characters are obsessed with time travel. Heinrich Tannhaus, in 1822, when Gustav is a little boy, is talking about, I want to go through time so I can stop Charlotte, my wife Charlotte's death. But why would anybody at 1822 be thinking about going back in time? There weren't novels like The Time Machine then. Mm-hmm. Time travel in stories was really kind of light back, you know, before modern
times. So your theory is two Charlottes.
There's Tannhaus's granddaughter, Charlotte, which is the daughter of his son, Merrick, and his daughter-in-law, Sonia. Her body was never found. Where would it be if it could be anywhere? Well, it obviously couldn't be in the show because there's the Charlotte we know, which is the daughter of Noah and Elizabeth. And so that's the only reason
why. So you think older Charlotte, older Elizabeth did the old switcheroo.
Right. Or Cleflip 3 did it for some reason.
Uh-huh.
That would also explain why that pocket watch for Charlotte is so important.
Mm-hmm.
Because it went, the clockmaker made it. You know, he made it for his granddaughter. You know, it gets taken back when his granddaughter gets taken back in time to whenever it would have been, maybe even 1800. She grows up, she goes, dies. Then they have to get that pocket watch back so that it plays its time. That's my only thought on why that specific pocket watch would be so important that Cleflip 3 would kill for it. You know, it just doesn't, I don't know, it doesn't make any other sense. The other thing I want to say is that one of the reasons why I've come around on the ending is because it's just one ending. In one ending, you can be heartbroken that, oh, wait a minute, Jonas never really exists, Martha never really exists. People who you love, like Magnus and Francisca, what did they do to never exist? Why is it their fault that they now never exist? There are so many characters. Why is it Agnes's fault that she never really exists? All this stuff. But to me, they have to have existed. Now, there's just one loop where they don't, meaning the loop where Jonas and Alt Martha stop Tannhaus's son from driving in the river. But there's another version where they do, because obviously that's the only way the whole thing works. And so I'm not, yes, in one world, in one infinity loop, they got dusted out of existence. Thanos snapped them out of existence. But they did exist in the other loop, and they did have those experiences. And one of the things that really I think about is that Adam was always so focused on all the horrors that happened to everybody. And there were a million horrors and terrible things that happened to all the characters. But there were moments of happiness for everybody. You know, Bartosz, look at him for a bit. He really had a miserable time. He loved Martha. That didn't work out for him. He's thrown back into the 1800s and he's completely miserable. But he did fall in love. He did have kids. He did have happy times. And so it seems a bit weird that those would never exist. Magnus and Francisca did have love across multiple worlds. And it would be sad if that didn't exist. But to me, they did exist. That is my big crazy theory on Dark. What do you think?
To me, I think if they went back before the split, then the split didn't happen.
But the only way they could go back before the split is if the split did happen. Sorry.
On that plane.
Listeners, we're going to be debating this forever.
Which cat?
Right, which cat? Schrodinger's cat. Is it alive? Is it dead? Is it both? I'm in the thought it's both. Or maybe there's three states because of the infamous Trinity knot on the cover of Dark. Hey, this is it. We're going to be back on our podcast for The Mandalorian, which is entitled Parsec Passion Podcast. Find that wherever you download podcasts. We're going to be back on that in October. We may be doing other seasons of other TV as well. But definitely follow us, like us, join us on Facebook, talk to us. We'll keep talking to you all throughout all three worlds that this podcast is released on. For everybody in the Winding Caves, my name's Bubba Tiny. I'm so glad that you came on this journey with me.
Bubba, thank you for all your theories and for noticing things that no one else would ever spend time to notice, take notes on, and put it in a podcast. This has been a great time. Thank you for all the double T's out there.
Time travelers.
We appreciate you. Thank you for everybody on the feedback. This has been super fun.
And you'll hear us next time, just as you heard us the first time, when you're deep. Deep, deep, deep in the Winding Caves. What happened to Wohler's eye?
Oh, no!